Very warm welcome to this session. As many of you are probably aware, we are here to talk about what our author here, Sugata Srinivas Raju, calls the unexplored life of H.D. Devegowda. A little background about Mr. Gowda before we get into the session, a little background about Sugata before we get into the session. Mr. H.D. Devegowda was born in Hassan, in a village in Hassan in 1933, right? A number of years before independence. And he's one of the few politicians who still in the modern day has kind of come up through the ranks. He began in local politics, made his way to state politics before, of course, unexpectedly rising to national famous prime minister in 1996. This up and down life of Mr. Gowda, right, is definitely the stuff of legend, right? The things he has done, the stances he's taken, right? The many different kinds of experiences he's had in the political sphere. And as Sugata points out in the book, he spent far more time in the opposition than he has actually in power, right? And that's something that not too many people perhaps realize at first sight. So what is the stuff of this life? What keeps such a person going? What were the many things that he did during this life, during his life, to get to the positions that he did? What were the problems that he faced? All of that is what Sugata explores in his book. Sugata's own background is largely in journalism. He's worked with Outlook magazine. He's worked with a number of Kannada publications. And he is now currently a political columnist writing for several national and local newspapers. I cannot think of a better person than Sugata, someone who has observed Karnataka politics for the last 3 or 4 decades, to write this biography. And over the next few minutes, myself and Vikar Ahmad Saeed here, who is with the front line, also a very close observer of politics in Karnataka, are going to pick Sugata's brains about Mr. Gowda, as well as, of course, the whole idea of writing a biography of a person who is still alive and very, very active in the political scenario. So I'd request Vikar to start with his first question.
Thank you, Karthik. Before I ask my first question, Sugata, it's a tremendous honor to be here with you. And you know, the book is 600 pages. So it's a magnificent accomplishment, and I admire the fact that Sugata has written this book in 3 years. I find that unbelievable. Karthik, who's worked with a lot of authors, will be delighted that there is an author here who's completed this rather intricate and complicated narrative of a person who's almost 90 and who's occupied such a large space in Karnataka politics mainly and in national politics. So let me start off. A few days ago, after I'd read the book, we had a conversation, and then I'd said, a major purpose of the book seems to be to rehabilitate the legacy of Devegowda. And you had disagreed with me. And you had used a rather lovely phrase when you said it's not about rehabilitating his legacy, but it's about restoring the balance. So my first question is, why does someone like Devegowda need his legacy to be restored? You know, at one point you write this very succinctly, the larger social, cultural and political prejudice that surrounds him, Mr. Gowda, has not allowed credit to accrue on the riverbank of his public life. You know, for someone like us, for a lot of us, we've seen Mr. Gowda to be a patriarch, a leader of a dominant community. So when you use a word like prejudice, it is a little confounding. So if you could explain that, we could start off. Thank you.
Thank you, Vikar, and thank you, Karthik. I'm equally honored to be in the company of two very enlightened friends. So this is a question that I try to answer, I've tried to answer in the interview that I've done with you for Frontline Magazine. See, when I started work on this biography, and whenever I told people that I'm trying to do a biography of Devegowda, they scoffed at me. They said, does Mr. Devegowda deserve a Penguin biography, an international level, whatever thing? And then they would tell me, do you have enough to fill up the pages? Without realizing that this man had been in politics for close to 7 decades. See, he became a member of the Congress Party in 1952. And 1954 is his first brush with some kind of electoral game. So he'd been in politics for 70 years. And as Karthik rightly pointed out, of all those 70 years, only 7 years he had executive power. Only 7 years. And the rest of it was spent in opposition. And if you have to, in India, especially in Indian politics, if you have to be in opposition and survive for that long, the stamina that you need is enormous. I don't think there is another politician in India who has survived oppositional game for such a long time. Because everybody, Chandrasekhar is probably one exception that I can think of, who actually was a stalwart in the opposition. But he, again, like Gowda, never sort of enjoyed executive power. So I was scoffed at when I started out. But I would like to tell you that Mr. Devegowda is looked at through the prism of caste in Karnataka, and that's a very myopic idea. See, caste game is played by everybody. Didn't Nijalingappa do it? Nijalingappa, Devraj Aras, and Ramakrishna Hegde or Virendra Patil, all of them played the caste game. And if you know how Mr. Kengal Hanumanthaya was just asked to leave the chair the moment 1956 happened and the entire electoral balance tilted, you will realize that Karnataka has always been a caste thing. So Mr. Devegowda doing a caste game is not a big thing. It's part of the general culture in Karnataka, and everybody is playing that game. And the man who actually creates havoc with the caste game is Devraj Aras between 1972 and 1980, because he splinters castes, he plays one against the other, he brings in the idea of backward class reservation, all pioneering things, and all, you know, I mean, something unthinkable, because he had to survive. He came from a micro minority community which probably had 16,000 people across the state, and he had to survive. So he kept the Okaligas close to him, he played against the Lingayats, and he did a lot of things. You know, the Ahinda idea that we talk of today, the backwards, the Dalits and the minorities and all of them coming together, was an idea that had its genesis in the politics of Devraj Aras. So Devegowda was not doing anything unusual. That's the first thing that I want to tell you. But then what is it that he was doing that was not the others were doing, say a Ramakrishna Hegde? I mean, I would still not come to Ramakrishna Hegde, but then what is it that others were not doing, which Gowda was doing, and which was creating a halo around him without many of them noticing? He was always a politician. If you look at his parliamentary record, if you look at his very first speech in 1962 in the Mysore State Assembly, it was still the Mysore State Assembly then, it is on Kaveri, and he gives you specific ideas as to how to harness the waters of the Kaveri and how to sort of develop the Harangi Basin or the Hemavati Basin. And he's coming up with specific ideas, and he's just 29 years old as an MLA. So Devegowda, right from day one of his politics, went with big ideas. He was a politician who mixed caste with big ideas and a certain kind of a constructive, progressive, developmental dream. So that was something unusual in Karnataka. See, if you look at what happened with the Krishna, Devegowda's contribution is not majorly to Kaveri, because Kaveri was a decided thing. You only had to fight legal battles, and legal battles had to be settled at the highest level. So Kaveri was just a legal dispute. So harnessing of Kaveri was not the major thing, because it was all done by the Maharaja then. But his greatest contribution is to the Krishna Basin, which nobody remembers. If you look at how he negotiated World Bank loans, after it had been suspended, lapsed, people like Nijlingappa sat over it, people like Virendra Patil sat over it. So for 20, 30 years, nothing had moved at the World Bank. I quote from the World Bank documents that how the whole thing had been suspended, and this man goes there and revives it. And he, as a chief minister, what he does to the Krishna Basin, setting of the dam height or bringing in resources or thinking of new ideas like the Krishna Jalabhagya Nigam, you know, trying to you know, go public with a very, very, you know, an idea, developmental idea, and go raise money in the market, was happening for the very first time in India. And that idea, Devegowda comes up and people don't buy the shares.
Even so, the rehabilitation.
Absolutely. The rehabilitation is a massive thing for which the World Bank is stunned the way this man has accomplished it. But what he does with the shares is that people don't pick up the Krishna Jalabhagya Nigam shares. So he just goes and puts his own money there and he says, see, I have bought it, you can buy it. And then there is a flood of money coming in. And what he does as prime minister, giving money permanently, even to this day, that project has not been discarded by any prime minister, which is the accelerated irrigation program. So Devegowda was a man, I've just mentioned just one idea, that is the irrigation idea. He has several such big ideas which he works on, which is mentioned in the book, with related to agriculture or the Northeast or Kashmir or Punjab or even Narmada. In 2019, I trailed him to Narmada when the water reached its full height at the dam. And he was completely pissed with his idea that Modi was taking credit. So he said, I'm going to that dam. I want to tell the people of Gujarat that I set the height of your dam, not Modi. And he challenged Modi. He said, now go and increase it by 1 inch. Let us see. So, and Modi actually went and announced. And the first resistance came from his own state in Madhya Pradesh. The chief minister of Madhya Pradesh said, no, sir, please don't do this. We'll get into trouble. So Devegowda then sort of was vindicated. So Devegowda is not just caste. And the Karnataka game, which I think Vikar rightly pointed out, the socio-cultural prejudice, he was a Shudra. And the media was controlled as it is today by the Brahmins. So I'm being very upfront on these things. I speak about it and I also quote enormously. I look at the constitution of newsrooms at that time. Who were chief reporters? Who were editors? Even Mr. James Maynard writes about it in his book. So I'm not the first to point it out, but I do it in a much more, in a straightforward way. So he was always seen as Ramakrishna Hegde's rival, which is very, very unfortunate. A leader who is actually getting Ramakrishna Hegde elected because Ramakrishna Hegde does not have a constituency. After the 1957 thing, Ramakrishna Hegde has never got elected. He was always going through the upper houses. So even the only public election that he contests in Bagalkot in 89, when he thinks that VP Singh will be prime minister, he's defeated by a rookie. And in 83, when he becomes chief minister through the back door, and I describe the whole process, there is rebellion in the Wakaliga ranks. And Devegowda collects all these people under a tree in Kabban Park. And he says, I have given my word to Chandrasekhar. I am a man of my word. Hegde shall be chief minister. That is when Bangarappa rebels and leaves the whole Krantiranga. He leaves the whole, coalition and goes away. He tells Devegowda, which is there in the, it's public record, and I've quoted from public record, where he tells Devegowda, you become or I become. I will never allow that Hegde to become. And since it's already been decided and they need, 7 or 14 of these BJP MLAs and all that, so there is some arrangement with Vajpayee, and there is a different kind of caucus which is operating, and Devegowda loses his second chance to become chief minister. The first was he was declared in 78 as the chief ministerial candidate. I write about the machinations and maneuvering that happens in 78 also. So this is the kind of man. This is a small idea, a glimpse that I try to give you. I allow them to ask more questions, and if more questions come up, I can clarify.
Okay. Going to the sunrise aspect or sunrise phase of Mr. Gowda's career, right? He was elected in 1962 as an independent, even though for some time he was a member of the Congress before that, right? And the independents as a category have more or less disappeared or at least gone off the radar, both in national and state politics. And I imagine it couldn't have been easier back then either, you know, for an independent to kind of, you know, win the support of the people with no party backing him. How do you think he managed to do that at that phase in his career?
See, not many people would know Devegowda was expelled from the Congress party. See, that is because there is this Nijlingappa versus Jati faction in the Congress. And Devegowda's mentor, Mr. A.G. Ramachandra Rao, who was the education minister under Kengal Hanumanthaiya, was a confidant of Jati. So Devegowda is seen as a Jati man by Nijlingappa. And his name is proposed for the Holenarsipur seat as an MLA. And that is because Ramachandra Rao is already 80 and he wants to retire. And this man is extremely popular in the constituency. I'll tell you why he was popular later. But it's this man he's supposed to get the ticket. And his name has been proposed by the district committee, by the taluk committee, and it goes to the state committee. It's also cleared by the state committee. And then there is again a sleight of hand in Delhi. And when it comes back, a different Devegowda with a different initial is given the ticket. So that is the Congress party for you. So he is extremely popular. He's known by then as the bicycle man in Holenarsipur because he's a civil works contractor. He's a qualified engineer. He has built one of the, tank bunds, which is very, very popular. He has taken on some Muslim contractors who are creating trouble there. And he has become a local hero. So in morning, he gets up in his home in Hardanalli, cycles to Holenarsipur, does all his politicking. And then comes back and he's very, very popular and people are enraged that he's not going to get a ticket. So the suggestion actually comes from a local physician. He says, Devegowda, don't worry. You just contest. Let us see. You challenge the Congress party. So he declares himself as an independent candidate and his boss is worried. His guru, A.J. Ramachandra Rao, who's still a loyal congressman, a Nehruvian, is completely worried that Devegowda is doing this. So he secretly calls Mr. Devegowda and he says, you are my Shishya. I'm very happy that you're going to contest, but I cannot campaign for you because I'm a loyal congressman. He says, no, sir. I mean, Devegowda and Mr. Chiranjeev Singh, who speaks in the book, also tells me he has been an SP, a DC in Mandya. He says, these Okaligas are extremely emotional people. So he says, no, sir, I don't want you to campaign. I only want you to bless me. And he falls at his feet. So then when he gets up, Mr. Ramachandra Rao tells him, there's one other thing I want you to do before you file your nomination. There is a person called Achyut Shastri in Mysore. He's a top class astrologer. You go and ask him if you will win and then you file your nomination. Because it's not an easy thing. It's as tough as today, right? So Devegowda does this overnight trip to there and then he meets Achyut Shastri. And Achyut Shastri takes time and then once he says Ramachandra Rao, he's let in. And then he gives his biodata, which is his horoscope written by one Bandi Narasimha Iyengar. His father would have got it done by giving three sheep as a payment. And would have got, he's the firstborn. So his father is very, very, curious to know what will happen to the son. And he has lost three children from his first wife. They've all died in 1 week. So he's the second marriage, firstborn. So he's a very melancholic character. If you look at Mr. Devegowda, the pensiveness comes from his father. He's a very melancholic character. Mr. Nariman in the Delhi launch pointed out right at the beginning. He said, this picture is the Devegowda I identify. I've seen him like this for 40 years. He's a very pensive character. So that melancholia is there in him. So this Achyut Shastri looks at him and he says, looks at the chart, horoscope, and he says, I will throw my Janehu or Janivar if you don't win. You are meant to become something in this country. Go and happily file your nomination. So he again goes back to Ramachandra Rao, touches his feet and files his nomination. And he is elected by a good margin, not a small margin, but a huge margin. And he's expelled from the Congress party. So he's expelled for 6 years. So even the next election, he can't contest on a Congress ticket. So he contests again. By then he has done a lot of work. The Hemavati thing is accomplished because he passes a He pilots a private member resolution in 63 and challenges both Nijlingappa and Virendra Patil saying that I will move this bill resolution for completing the works on the Kaveri Basin. So they are very embarrassed. They say, don't do it, Gowda. We will do it for you. And he goes and, you know, he's without spending a penny, he sort of goes from village to village, you know, surveying himself, how to go about doing it. And he's an engineer, basically, so has some basic knowledge. He reads up. Reading is another thing which people don't know about him. He is a voracious reader and he can surprise you. So he goes, he does the survey on a cycle, comes back, speaks in the assembly. If you just look at that marvelous record between just that 62 to 69, marvelous speeches. I'm really ashamed that none of us have even paid attention to those speeches, which are 2 hours, 1.5 hours. See, now the parliamentary rule has changed. It is dependent on the size of your party. Earlier, it was dependent on the wish and the executive thing of the speaker. So if the speaker liked what you were proposing, he could allow you time. So now it has completely changed. Nobody can speak for such long. And if you don't have other, you know, party strength, you can't speak. So he does that. And then when they renege on their promise, Nijlingappa and Virendra Patil, he again brings back that resolution in the assembly. And they are really scared that this fellow is going to pit the Okaligas against the Lingayats. So they just announce all these schemes. They go about implementing it. And Devegowda is happy. And he goes and, I mean, quite rightly takes credit for what he has done to the Kaveri Basin. See, please remember, Devegowda was not an elite Okaliga. There were enormous big Okaligas at that time who were much, much bigger than him. And Devegowda's father was working on 4 ragged acres in the boring plains of Assam, as I say. And he was not, it was not a family which wore a zari brocaded turban. So he did not belong to the elite Okaliga. He was a small time Okaliga, first generation literate. His father was unlettered, mother was unlettered. And here is a man self-educating himself, looking at very complex treaties signed on. He, even if you go to his office today, you will see all river water treaties signed across the globe, which is preserved. You know, that's one great resource which I requested him to hand it over to the National Archives, because he has everything. He has read everything. Then there are margin notes. He will tell you how a certain African treaty was signed and with what great difficulty. Even to this day, he's consulted by very big nations on when there is a river water dispute that a lot of people do not know. And these are some of the things that he does. And so that is his place under the sun, not just a caste leader. And even as an Okaliga, he was not a big Okaliga. There were much bigger Okaligas at that time. So he became a people's man. He became the patriarch of the Kaveri Basin. He became an electoral magic. And that is how he survived his stint in opposition. And he does not take salary as an opposition leader because he thinks he'll be obliged to Aras. So he goes walking every day from his hostel room, which has no bathroom. He's using a common toilet. And he goes and fights Aras like that, the mighty Aras.
Yeah. You know, for me, my favorite chapter is his epic battle with Ramakrishna Hegde. Yes. If I can just read 3 or 4 lines, how the chapter starts. I mean, for listeners to get a sense of Sugata's narrative and eloquent prose. To say Devegowda and Ramakrishna Hegde are two very complex individuals is a surrender to banality. The two, for a stretch of time, appeared to be dependent on each other and were also defined by each other in Karnataka politics. Yet, even as they progressed as comrades for decades, they remained fiercely competitive. So, I mean, if you could briefly describe, you know, this comradeship that turns to rivalry, intense rivalry. You show how Hegde makes a very derogatory comment when Devegowda is picked to be the prime minister of the country. And if you could just discuss this relationship.
I've already mentioned a small little thing about Hegde not having a constituency. And Hegde became popular only after he became chief minister. So he contested the Basangudi seat and he won only when he was chief minister. Otherwise, he didn't have a constituency. And Devegowda, it was, if I use the metaphor that P. Lankesh used for Devegowda and Ramakrishna Hegde, I think the whole thing will become very clear. he called Ramakrishna Hegde a fox and he called Devegowda an ox. So you know who was hardworking and who was actually manipulating. So that metaphor should actually tell you the whole thing. But let us not be uncharitable to Mr. Hegde. Hegde was also a man of ideas. See, Hegde didn't have he came from a small community, and Karnataka politics was aligned in such a way that caste was very, very central. But then he was a man of great ideas. You know, the Panchayat Raj legislation and all that was his idea. And he was also eyeing the prime ministerial chair. So that is where he gets into a kind of tug of war with Rajiv Gandhi, who is the prime minister then. So Rajiv Gandhi thinks that, who is this fellow? You know, I am entitled to be the prime minister of this country. And everybody, including Salman Rushdie, is writing that Ramakrishna Hegde may one day become prime minister. It's there in his imaginary homelands. So Rajiv Gandhi gets into an alliance with Devegowda. So Rajiv Gandhi and Devegowda are the thickest of friends in that phase. So that should tell you how Devegowda operated. Devegowda was very, very close to all prime ministers. It comes out in the book. He was very close to Indira Gandhi, who tried to bring him on her side. He did not, although he was in jail and emergency and all that, he did not go with her. Rajiv Gandhi was in really love with him. You know, I mean, that is the kind of relationship they had. He even predicts his death. That comes out of the chapter. So this Ramakrishna Hegde and Devegowda, the ox and the fox thing aside, besides that, Hegde, because of his ambition and because of the rustic imagery, rustic kind of thing that Devegowda was, he never thought Devegowda will overtake him. But you should remember, at that time in national politics, there was an NTR who was popular like Devegowda. There was a Biju Patnaik who was a popular man. And there was a Jyoti Basu who had already been chief minister for 20 years. There was a Lalu Prasad Yadav who was shining and who had arrested Advani. So that was the kind of coalition game that we were seeing then. And Hegde naturally sort of, you know, does not figure in that kind of thing. And he's very, very upset when Devegowda is picked as prime minister. Let me tell you again that the left, I clarified this in Delhi many times when I was speaking there recently, that it was the left that picks Devegowda. Devegowda does not want to be prime minister. He's a reluctant prime minister. And Basu tells him, Devegowda, you better agree. Otherwise, do you think I can go and advertise in the Times of India and tell them that we don't have a secular candidate against Vajpayee? Don't be childish. You know, you accept this. And Devegowda falls at his feet and he says, sir, I've been chief minister only 2 years. I want to be like you, ruling Karnataka for 25 years. What are you doing to my career? So there is that heated debate between him and Lalu is standing in a corner, and Basu turns to him and he says, just go and announce that Devegowda is our prime minister. And I tell you, Basu is very, very confident. Surjit and Basu, see, they are not jokers. If people think that they were jokers or some people who did not think through the whole thing, it's foolish. Basu has observed Devegowda from 74. And he reasons out in his oral archives interview at the Nehru Memorial Library as to why he thought Devegowda was a great administrator. Devegowda was a man of great, big ideas. And he thought only Devegowda can handle the bureaucracy of India. And he thought that anybody less would make left look very, very small, because he is their candidate. And if he has the veto because he has declined the prime ministership, and he has to put up somebody now because V.P. Singh has also declined, and he wants a solid candidate, and he puts up Devegowda, and Devegowda does not disappoint him. The kind of work he does is amazing after he becomes prime minister. And at that point, Ramakrishna Hegde, like many times before, spoils or sullies his finest moment as an individual. He goes out and says, this man does not know the geography of the country and you're making him prime minister. And he goes on insulting him in the press every day. And Lalu and Bommai are the one who decide that he should be expelled. And of course, Devegowda is happy that they have arrived at that decision. But it is Bommai and Lalu Prasad Yadav who push Devegowda. And of course, there is a party mechanism there. And they just push him out of the party. And Devegowda is so depressed in his first few weeks as prime minister that He's unhappy that a man who knew him for 4 decades is speaking about him as if he's a street side guy who does not know anything. And the media is picking it up because, again, there is a nexus between the media and the upper caste. Because the media is dominated by the upper caste. I'm sorry to say this. Even to this day, I've been an editor of the biggest newspapers in India. I mean, I edited a paper which had a readership of 8 million. I know what happens in a newsroom. And that gets carried. He's projected as a sleeping prime minister. He has a retina problem. He's putting his eyes down like this, head down like this. He has a medical issue. And Devegowda is not even clarifying these things. And even to me, he did not clarify. I had to pick up all this in the accounts of his top bureaucrats who are, again, see, we don't have to be prejudiced against the upper caste, but some of the finest people who served Devegowda, like T.S.R. Subramaniam, Satish Chandran, Meenakshi Sundaram, Yugandhar, the best creme de la creme of Indian bureaucracy, were all upper caste men. And they see this man as a remarkable administrator, which they write about also. Even Montek Singh Ahluwalia in my book, who was his finance secretary, and P. Chidambaram says that all that sleeping thing was a nonsense. And they'd speak about how belligerent he would be in the cabinet meetings. And he would tell them that what you're talking is nonsense. Let's not do it that way. He would completely invert the whole thing. And Montek Singh Ahluwalia gives examples of how he does that. He says that was a mass leader talking in the cabinet. And he was a very adhyayanashil prime minister and a chief minister and a legislator. So he used to read a lot, and only rarely did you get a glimpse of it. Suddenly, I mean, I quote this thing about 2002 or 2003, he's talking full passion against Vajpayee in the parliament. And suddenly he says, what do you know? Stiglitz says this in his latest book. And then, I mean, he's quoting para and verse from Joseph Stiglitz, who is then the advisor to Clinton and also has won a Nobel Prize. He doesn't know that he has won a Nobel Prize. He's saying that Clinton's advisor, he writes this. What do you know? You are trying to say this. And then he becomes conscious that he's quoting a big author. Then he starts his humble farmer thing. So he's pretending all the time. And even now, you know, I mean, I speak about this when the China thing, see, he's constantly consulted by the UN. He's consulted by the World Bank. Even to this day, I mean, I think Saeed mentioned, Vikar mentioned about the World Bank thing. And then, so there, even the rehabilitation, you spoke about the rehabilitation. Even to this day in the World Bank, when South Asian countries are given the rehabilitation package, it's called the Devegowda package, even to this day. And this is not Devegowda tom-tomming about himself. Devegowda is not doing this. Devegowda is forgotten to mention all of this to you. This is the World Bank recognizing him. Then if you look at the farmers of Punjab, nobody told this to Devegowda that the best paddy variety in Punjab is called Devegowda. Even to this day, it's called Devegowda. And people say if you use Devegowda, the paddy variety, you never lose money. That is the myth in Punjab. And Mr. Chiranjeev Singh was the first one who told me about it. And then we both went looking for it. And that is a marvelous story by itself. And if you look at Kashmir, if you just have to listen to what Farooq Abdullah said on the 13th when he was launching my book, he cried and he said, even to this day, if there is one prime minister of India that the people of Kashmir trust, it is Devegowda. And why? It is there in the book. And he said, until my last breath, this is Farooq Abdullah saying this. I'm not saying this. Until my last breath, I will be loyal to you. I'll be grateful to you. The people of my state will be grateful to you for what you did, because Abdullah would have just left Kashmir and gone away in 91 after the suspension of democracy in that state. Devegowda says, don't fear anything. Be like your father, be a lion. You come back from London, I will organize an election. I will conduct an election. So then there is a huge problem. People will say that election is rigged, that is rigged. So he does one marvelous thing. He first calls the international press. He says, from tomorrow, you can go to any corner of Kashmir and report. Now just imagine if something can be done today. Even I can't report, Vikar can't report. And we have all been hounded. So he says, go and report from any corner of Kashmir. The second thing he does is he calls the most important ambassadors, European Union American ambassadors. He says, "Sir, can you do me a favor?" He has called them for a breakfast meeting. These are all minuted. I'm not, you know, building a story for Mr. Devegowda. These are all minuted things. So he says, "Sir, can you do a favor for me?" Then they say, "Sir, please tell us." He says, "You be the special observers of the election. You report to your own countries independently if I rig the elections." This is Devegowda. And this is his democratic engagement. And that man is reduced to being a caste leader in the state. It's very unfortunate. Yeah, his vindictiveness, his skullduggery, that's all a separate story. That all of you have narrated it for decades. I don't have to tell you. But there is another side of the man which we did not seem to care until we saw another prime minister who did not want to engage democratically, who now has shunned the press, has manipulated the press, has removed, done everything possible in Kashmir. He has done everything possible in the Northeast. And the Northeast, he's worshipped even to this day, Devegowda. When the Bogeybeel Bridge was inaugurated in 2019, Modi went to inaugurate. People held placards and they said, "Get Devegowda. He did the planning. He gave us money. He, as the first ever Prime Minister of India, came and stayed with us for 6 days." And there, it was all over the papers. I quote from those papers. So this is the man whom I try to explore. And that is why I call this is an unexplored life of Devegowda.
Right. We have time for one or two questions from the audience. Yes.
Sir, it was very good. I have not yet to read the book. Coming to Bangalore, which is now Silicon Valley across the globe, it's many unexplored that during Devegowda CM only, he laid the foundation and did
absolutely.
Many
absolutely. That's there in the book. But the biggest revolution that he does is in the 97 budget, which is credited only to Chidambaram. It's called the dream budget of India. That is the unraveling of the liberal thing. It's actually, if you see the book, even Chidambaram speaks about it. How many fights Devegowda has with Chidambaram saying, "No, we'll do this." And one of them is also the opening up of the telecom sector. If there was no internet, if the telecom sector had not been opened up, you wouldn't have a mobile phone in your pocket. You wouldn't have internet. We wouldn't be live streaming. And Devegowda, just not that, even infrastructure, electronic city, or the
ITPL,
all of them, you know, ring road to ease traffic. And not just that, you know, tax holidays. All of these are part of his legacy, which you wrongly attributed to a man who was giving free sites to journalists called S.M. Krishna. I mean, this is you. Devegowda never spent a penny on publicity. He never thought he needed it. He said, "People will vote me. I don't need this kind," because he was always being hounded. He was always being run down. So, I mean, as a journalist, I can tell you, Vikar will vouch for me. We were both reporting. We have been reporting Karnataka. The kind of lurements that were offered to us, we were seen as black sheep who were not accepting these kind of, you know, I mean, freebies that were being offered. So to tell me that there is no diversity in our newsrooms, people don't speak the truth, and when somebody does some good work, somebody appropriates it. So that is you're right about the IT revolution. And even in 2005, he takes on Narayan Murthy, because Narayan Murthy wants more acres of land, and he asks him a pertinent question: "What have you done with the 77 acres I gave you?" Kargil seats mess. See, Enron was, I mean, I don't think Devegowda cleared it. You know, Devegowda's chief minister was one of those. It was cleared in the Bangarappa time. And I don't think he had anything to do with it. You know, there was one small allegation that comes up about Cogentrix, where they say that he has received kickbacks. This is something which was raised in parliament by George Fernandes and Maneka Gandhi. And then he asked for proof, and the proof is not delivered. And that was the allegation. So I can't comment on something about which there is no evidence. There are several such allegations, but as journalists and as writers and as someone responsibly writing a book, you can only go by evidence. But I've mentioned it. It's not that I've read it in the book. The Cogentrix debate is mentioned in the book. You shall be happy to read about it.
So thank you very much, Sugata. Thank you, Vikar. We have come to the end of the session. clearly there is so much more to Mr. Gowda than meets the eye or than what common sense seems to tell us. So I would encourage all of you to buy the book, read the book. There's much to learn there. There's much insights to be gained there. So have a great day. Thank you very much.
And it's not a flat last word, if I can snatch it from Karthik. It's not a flattering note. It's a narrative biography. It's not a judgmental biography. So if you think that since I spoke only positive things and there's only positive things about Devegowda, please don't. Please be happy that there are all other things as well. Thank you very much.